Hey there, Mr. Reddit here. Welcome back to another episode of r/EntitledParentStories. Our first story we'll be reading today. My wife gave away thousands from our savings account without telling me. After that, we both know you don't have time to read all that. Give me my A. And after that, you want me to sue? Well, if you insist. Now for every thumbs up this video gets, one Karen doesn't get to give away anyone else's money. Joke's on you, Reddit boy. I already have. So please smash that like button. And if you're new, subscribe and turn on notifications for new stories from Reddit every single day. Wife gave away thousands from our savings account without telling me. I, 39 male, have been married to my wife, 36 female, for 12 years. We have no kids, but we do have a cat and a dog who we consider to be our kids. My wife has a sister, M, who's 37 female, who has made very poor financial choices and is now heavily in debt. She refuses to get a job and instead jumps from an MLM or get-rich-quick scam to the next, sponging off of relatives to make ends meet. Both me and my wife work full-time. We each have separate accounts that we use for our fun money for hobbies and whatever we want. We earn almost the same amount of money, with me being a little higher. So I contribute 60% and she contributes 40% to make things fair, and also so we each have about the same amount of fun money. We also have a joint checking and savings account that we use for the household bills and household emergency fund, like when the water heater flooded the basement in the middle of the night. Both of us have access to the joint accounts, and if we need to use it, it's never an issue, so long as we make sure to tell the other one that we used funds from those accounts. As I was going through this statement for our joint household account, I noticed that there was approximately $2,000 missing from the joint savings account. I noticed that they were all Venmo transfers to her sister. When my wife came home from work, I asked what this was about, and she told me that her sister needed money to start her own business. My wife sat me down and explained to me that her sister joined yet another pyramid scheme, this time selling fake nails and makeup. My wife said that she has the potential to earn six figures a month, and if that was true, my wife also said that she too was going to join her sister selling these products, and if she made enough, she would quit her job and sell them full-time with her sister. I told my wife that either she needs to get that money back from her sister, or I would open a new account for my share of the household expenses and transfer it to that account when it was time to pay bills. My wife is upset with me and does not understand why I'm being so unsupportive. I told my wife that not only did she take money and not tell me about it, she invested it into something without even considering how I would feel about it. My sister-in-law called me last night and said that I was a raging jerk and a control freak, and that I was stopping my wife from using her full potential. I told my sister-in-law that I would support my wife in anything she chooses to do, as long as it would not cause financial harm to our family. My wife and sister-in-law are both upset with me, and now I feel like a jerk. Am I the jerk for telling my wife to get the money back? Well, who do you think is the jerk? OP or his sister-in-law? Please let us know. The only ones who will be making six figures a month are the ones running the whole pyramid scheme. Never give large amounts of money to people who don't know how to manage it. We both know you don't have time to read all that. Give me my A. Some very short context to this story. I am not a natural citizen. I'm a naturalized immigrant. I was 6 when I arrived and, understandably, had issues with the language and was assigned English as a second language classes. Once those were finished, I made it my goal to never get anything below a 90 on any written assignment that was graded. And right up until college, I'm very proud to say I never got below a 94 on any papers or essays or other writing assignments. This happened a while back in college. I was forced to take a critical writing class and multidisciplinary too. It was fun, getting to interact with people not in my major at the time. Unfortunately, it also meant I was grouped with people who had no idea what I was doing, nor did I know what they were doing. I got into this classroom and it's very open. The campus I go to is notorious for constantly renovating buildings, and the 7 years I was there, there was never a time that construction work wasn't going on. The building had just been erected and was a brand new science building. In said science building were some modular classrooms, the campus's attempt to change things up and get rid of the traditional lecture style of teaching by forcing the professors to walk among the students and teach. It was meant to encourage engagement and ease of access to students. Anyone who has sat in a lecture hall knows how irritating it is when Stacy in the middle of the row has a question during the exam and the professor or one of their TAs has to squeeze past everyone to get to her just so they can answer with, "Do your best," then slide their way back out. This class began with the professor trying her best to be all fun and encouraging. Unfortunately, her method of fun and encouraging was to treat a bunch of adults like they were in grade school by making them all get up and share their names and fun facts at 7:20 p.m. After this debacle, when we're all ready to get on with the first class of semester, she launches into the syllabus and explains things. She states that, similar to standard lecture classes, which usually have 3 to 4 exams total, her class will have 4 papers to be turned in over the course of the semester. However, if the students weren't happy with their grade, they had the option to either rewrite 2 papers once over or rewrite the same paper twice if their second attempt didn't warrant a good enough grade. These rewrites could be submitted whenever the student wanted. It sounded like a fantastic idea, and the way she sold it, it sounded like a surefire way to not fail. I was confident that I didn't need those chances to rewrite anything, and after class, I asked the professor if I could set up a gamble with her. Given my schedule at the time, a warehouse job, a full-time job at an urgent care, another part-time job at a CPA's office, and a full college workload, I asked if I could use those rewrites as an extension. It wouldn't be indefinite, but rather each would count as a week. If a paper was due February 7th, I could theoretically use up those 2 rewrites and extend the due date till February 21st. Initially, she refused, but I explained to her that my father had just passed, and given that it was sudden, we hadn't had the money available to pay for the funeral services and didn't have the money to travel back home to perform last rites, so I needed those 3 jobs to make ends meet. She understood and made a note due to my circumstances. However, she did have a noticeable change in her demeanor towards me after learning of what I did for work. I assumed she was just being somber due to learning about my father's passing. Well, in comes my first paper due. I did my usual thing, wrote my paper, edited, gave it a day, reread and edited it again, checked with rubric and re-edited. I was satisfied and turned it in, and a week later, she drops this paper with a big fat 68 on it. I'm like, "Excuse the heck out of me?" I go and speak to her at the end of class, and she said I hadn't understood what the paper was about. She was asking the students to write about how people in my field transition from school to career. I explained to her that it was very normal, and in some cases expected, to post your school projects on your portfolio while you worked on other projects on your own to hone and improve your skills. She just wasn't able to understand that, and very tactfully, but obviously, said that I was just making it up because no company would hire an individual based on their school projects / homework assignments. She then stated that she would be canceling our agreement and going back to the original that she had written with everyone else. I told her I wanted to discuss it with her more, but the only options she gave me were very conveniently during my work hours. I even asked for video calls, and she said her only available hours were during my warehouse work hours. Just the way she said it, I could tell she didn't think much of my choices in work. I accepted, mostly due to exhaustion, but I was this close to getting through schooling with not a single paper below 90, and I wasn't about to have this woman ruin it for me now. So I met with her at the end of the next class and asked her when the rewrite was due. She printed out a rubric for me to follow along. I asked her if she wouldn't mind signing it, because it has happened to a friend of mine where she has written something up following the rubric, only to have the professor accuse her of falsifying a rubric to skate by. She agreed to sign. The new rubric for my rewrite stated that it had to be a specific font, single-spaced, a specific font size, references in MLA style, etc., etc. The only thing that jumped out to me was a minimum of 5 pages. That seemed a bit strange to me because I've always used the subtractive method of writing, word vomit on the page, then cut out what's redundant. I was intending on asking her about it and walked to her office. However, she was in there talking about one of her students who was pretentious and trying to fit in where she didn't belong because she was just a labor class woman. The person she was talking to didn't sound all that comfortable, but she insisted on getting her little casual rage rant out, going on about how dare I try to readjust her rewrite plan to suit my needs, that it wasn't her fault I had to get crappy jobs, that she wasn't to blame, that I clearly didn't have the brains to do anything else or find a higher paying job. I didn't question it, however. I was told the due date was the end of semester. She said she'd end the class about a week early, so she would have that week to read everyone's final papers and submit grades on time, and I was welcome to drop my paper off at any time during that week. I agreed. Went through the semester and did perfectly fine on the other 2 papers, within my personal requirements, and settled in for the third. I was working on that paper as and when I could, emailing sections to myself when I was texting at work or taking a break and pulling out my laptop. Finally, I was done. I walked into her office with about 18 hours left before grades had to be submitted. She had hitched on a friendly smile and said, "Hey there, I'm glad you came by. I was worried perhaps you didn't want to rewrite after all." "Oh no, I did. I was just at work is all." "Oh yeah, how's that going?" "It's fine actually. I'm getting promoted soon, so I actually have to go. I just came by to drop off my paper."
"Oh, of course, of course. The warehouse job?"
"Yep."
"Mmm."
I swear, that darn mmm would have me gritting my teeth if I didn't have what was in my backpack. She holds out her hand while looking at the other papers, sort of with this, "I'm so busy that I don't even have time to look at the likes of you" vibe. So I pulled out my paper from my binder and dropped all 36 pages of it in her hand. All single spaced, all the correct font and font size, everything within parameters. She stared at it and then at me, and I just stared right back. "You said a minimum of 5.
"What is this nonsense? I would never assign a minimum page count. It said maximum.
If you check the 37th page, you'll see it's a copy of the rubric that you signed. And she flipped to it and realized she hadn't read her own rubric clearly. She done messed up. So to save face, she started rifling through my pages and nodding and random bits here and there.
"Okay, I'll give it a read and get your grade in by the end of the night."
I just rolled my eyes at her and said, "Look, we both know you don't have the time to read all that. Give me my A." We both were glaring daggers at each other, and she finally just gave in and scribbled a 98 on it and said she couldn't explain away an error-free 36 paper when hundreds of other students submitted much shorter pages with grammatical errors. I agreed, packed up my stuff, and told her that I could easily have reported her and used the other professor as evidence of the way she was talking about me behind my back. She got so incredibly pale and tried to call me as I left. Jerk, I'm Indian. Academics is in my blood. Don't test me, you'll fail miserably. Anyway, I got my A. Have you ever had a teacher who treated you horribly? If so, what did they do? Please let us know.
"I've got a co-host who treats me horribly. You need to respect me, Reddit boy."
"You want me to sue? Well, if you insist." My sunflower story seemed to go over well, so here's another lawyer story. I hope you enjoy it. None of the following is legal advice, and I am not your lawyer. On to the story. A friend from school reached out to ask for help dealing with an ambulance company. Her parent had passed away in an ambulance while traveling between a nursing home and a hospital. The ambulance company sent friend a bill which she could not afford to pay and was threatening to send the bill to collectors. "Not a problem, friend. Your parent's estate is responsible for this bill. You don't have a personal obligation to pay it, so they can't send it to collections in your name. Let me just mail a short letter and they should stop bothering you." I typed a very polite letter. "This person has legal representation. Please cease any and all shenanigans," and thought that was the end of this nonsense. Fast forward a few weeks when friend sent a picture of another bill. Because the law is so cut and dry on debt collection, I assumed the ambulance company had some computer or human error which caused another letter to be sent. "No worries, friend. I bet someone messed up. Let me give them a call real quick and figure it out." Imagine a super cool montage of me working through a really long automated phone tree before talking to an actual human. "Hey, I'm friend's lawyer. I sent a letter asking you to stop sending her collections notices. She got another notice yesterday, so I just wanted to figure out why and how to make sure these letters stop. Surely this will be a quick call, and we can all have a laugh about whatever error occurred, I think."
"We will stop sending her bills when she pays."
But that's pretty illegal for like a lot of reasons. I can think of 3 right off the top of my head. So instead of me getting all riled up and starting a lawsuit, can you just be cool, pretty please?"
"It's not illegal. Try to sue us if you want our lawyers to explain it to you."
She made me say the phrase that I hate more than any other phrase in the world. "May I speak to your manager, please?"
"Nope, I am the manager, and also more familiar with the FDCPA than you. What we are doing is perfectly legal. Tell your friend to pay."
So the FDCPA, Federal Debt Collections Practices Act, sets out certain rules for what debt collectors can or cannot do. But some states, like Texas, shocking I know, has stronger rules which protect debtors. I didn't know whether or not ambulance company was violating any FDCPA things, but I knew for sure, and when a good lawyer says for sure, that means 100% for sure, they were violating TDCPA. Telling me I don't know what I'm doing is rude. Hassling friend after parent passed away is shockingly rude. So last chance before I hang up to angry type a lawsuit and angry file it. You don't want me to sue on this because I will win.
Please do, and we will see you in court. Have a nice day.
Click. She hung up on me. Oh man, I was angry. Easily in the top 10 of upset in a professional context. The whole conversation took about 10 minutes. I have a fairly high tolerance for abrasive people. Most people don't look forward to talking with a lawyer, I get it. Still, sending collection notices to the wrong person after that person buried a parent and telling me that I'm a bad lawyer was pretty mind-blowing. I literally started working on this complaint as soon as I hung up, because if I threaten to sue and you ask me to follow through, my hands are tied. After I filed, the company was served, presumably followed by an actual lawyer reading the complaint and thinking, oh wow, we messed up here. A very apologetic lawyer called and we reached an agreement to settle, which included an apology to my friend. Pay me 2 hours now or 40 hours later to fix it plus $40,000 in taxes. A while back, I worked as a business consultant, certified public accountant, CPA, for young and startup companies. I was hired by a food delivery service client, think Uber Eats type delivery, with a primarily corporate clientele. After setting up the client's systems for payroll, accounting, banking, but not order entry or billing, the owner installed a new state-of-the-art order entry slash billing system. The new system seemed to work fine, but sales tax charged to clients were noticeably low and seemed to use the same rate for all cities slash suburbs and counties, even though each one had different additional rates over and above the base state rate. When brought to the attention of the owner, he insisted the new software company knew what they were doing and were experts in food delivery service billing. Later learned it was a small boutique firm from out of state with a very good salesperson. When I requested access to the system to check tax rates, I was told not to waste billable hours on the new system because he was certain they would know what they were doing and was unwilling to pay my exorbitant hourly rate to check something that was brand new. I explained if the taxes being collected were wrong, his company would be liable for any shortfall, showing examples of taxes being underbilled were met with, "You don't know what you're talking about." As the business grew, my consulting hours dropped off, just reviewing month and financial information with the client after closing the books each month, while making the requisite deposits of collateral sales tax to the State Department of Revenue. Malicious compliance. I had no control or access over the tax rates being billed, but I did know the state frequently scheduled audits of new companies after their first year of operations. If the client was unwilling to pay for a few hours to check the system, wait until it was necessary to pay for 40 billable hours to handle a state audit. Lo and behold, on the 13th month after installing the new software, a notice was received from the state announcing an audit of the client's sales and used tax payments was scheduled for the following week. To make a long story short, it was found that the new software did in fact only bill the base state sales tax rate, totally omitting both city and county taxes. The assessment for unpaid taxes, including penalty and interest, exceeded $40,000, not including my hourly rate to work with the state auditors. More billable hours were spent by me going back to the larger corporate customers and billing them for unpaid sales tax, recovering almost half of the assessment. Most were willing to pay after my threat to report them to the state for non-payment of use tax. The client blamed me for not insisting more strongly on changing the tax rates and terminated our relationship after it was felt as much as possible had been recovered from customers. That guy that never paid and then tried to make me the jerk. So I just commented on someone else's thread and it made me remember this one leech of a person that I had to put down in front of all of his peers because he tried to do me over for his drinks. Now, I shudder when I think about this. I suffer from bad secondhand embarrassment, and this interaction really burned itself into my brain by how awkward it was. But I came to realize that this person feels no shame anyways, so I might as well share it. So we own a restaurant in a small town in Germany. It's pretty common for this restaurant to have customers to come for dinner, or just having a drink at the bar. We got quite a few sports teams coming in to have a drink afterwards, and most of those guys I've known for years. Another thing that's common, especially in small towns where everyone knows everyone, is making a tab for customers. So if they drank more than they had money with them, or just forgot their wallets, they could come by to just pay next time. Now keep in mind that paying by card is far, far less common, or used to be since a few years ago, in Germany. Especially not if you only just pay small amounts, and while we did accept them when this happened, only for bigger amounts since we always paid a certain fee on every transaction. Now this guy was new to the team. After a while of him coming to our place, I noticed he always asked others to buy him a beer.
Next time it's on me, bro.
But he never paid for anything. Not his drinks, and of course, never for someone else. And after a few weeks, the others noticed too and stopped buying him drinks. So one time he asked me if I could write him a tab about one beer. He'll come by tomorrow and pay. And you know, since I did for others before and I kinda pitied him, I did it for him too. He did not show up. Next week neither. But after 2 weeks or something, my dad told me he owes one beer to him as well. He didn't see he already had an open tab that wasn't paid and just said okay. Then after a while, he started to come back, 100% thinking we would have forgotten it by then, and I had to start reminding him about his open bill. He would try to avoid me, let someone else bring him a beer by outside while he was smoking, so I wouldn't ask him. Now I was getting pretty upset, and this crap dragged on. I mean, obviously it wasn't a huge amount of money, and I'm usually a pretty patient person. But years back, there was this other guy who tried to pull this same thing, and I confronted him. He tried to put me into a bad light, and I learned my lessons from that. It's not even about the money at this point, it's about not letting myself get done over. The night this happened, this jerk walked up to the bar where the whole team was sitting and told me he'd like a beer. I was done with him at that point, and I can get really mean if you push me too far. So here's our conversation. Jerk.
Hey, can I get a beer?
Me. Do you have money?
What?
Do you have any money on you?
Well, no, actually.
Then there's no beer for you.
What? Why?
You know exactly why.
No, I don't.
Do we really have to discuss this in front of everyone right now? You know it, I know it, and you will not get crap from me if I don't see cash.
That's ridiculous. You act like I'm some kind of thief.
Dude, you still owe me 2 beers. I had to remind you several times, every time you promised to pay for it, and you never did. Then you tried to hide from me for weeks. I'm done with this crap.
What? Because of that little money, you act up like that?
Me. If it's such a ridiculous amount, then just pay it.
I think you should let it go for such a joke bill.
Me. What? Why in the heck should I? You owe money to me. I don't owe you crap.
Oh, really? Well, how about all the money we bring to this place every week?
Oh yeah, the others do. You, in fact, never spent one dime in here.
Gosh, you're being so pedantic. It's embarrassing.
Me. I have no reason to be embarrassed. You should be. You owe me. Do you really think you're the first person who tries to pull this crap? I'm mumbling to the others.
If I'm not the first, then she's not the smartest.
To which he got zero response from them. Me. Excuse me? Now you're really trying to drag me being sympathetic with someone being down bad into the dirt? Wow, you really are a jerk.
Sympathy? For me?
Well, if a grown man can't afford one single drink and always has to ask others to pay for him, that's kind of sad, you know?
What? You act like I'm some kind of beggar.
You act like one.
This is ridiculous. I'm leaving here and never coming back. Getting insulted like that by a waitress.
Me. That waitress at least doesn't owe anything to anyone.
Oh, so you think you're better than me?
In that aspect, clearly.
Forget you, jerk.
Get out of here. And he did. Now what got me the most was that all of his peers were dead silent while we argued and stared to the ground. While here I was, a small woman alone with 15 guys, burning one of them into the ground. I was shaking as I was so mad. And yes, this was very detailed. But this must have been one of my most jerk moves, and I couldn't even enjoy it because it felt so embarrassing actually. I swear, it haunted me. But I gotta say, I got a lot more respect after that, and someone else even offered to pay his open bill, which I found too kind, but I explained it never was about the money anyways. Edit 2. I wrote about how paying by cards was uncommon because he tried to use us not accepting cards for one beer as an excuse, and I told him I would absolutely make an exception if he would pay then, and he said he forgot his card. So there's that. Want me to just ignore your bug because you're slightly senior than me? Alright, bud. I work as a developer in a company that creates very fast automated systems for moving around money electronically. So obviously we have very strict testing and error checking for any code that goes in a production system. And I'm one of the guys who does this verification. So 3 months ago, I found a little bug in a patch that was written by this one other guy who had been working at the company for only a year longer than me. He has the title of senior developer, while I'm just a developer. It didn't really make any difference though. That was just something you get with a small pay raise once you do 3 years at the company as a developer. Anyway, I noticed this bug, email him, and tell him about it so he can fix it and resubmit the patch. But he turns the responsibility on me, tells me his code is correct and that I'm just testing it incorrectly. I try to explain to him, but he doesn't budge. Tired of the pointless arguing, I suggest that we should clear it out with our project manager. At this point, he pulls the seniority card and says I should just do as he says because I'm his junior. Now that upset me. This guy has absolutely no authority over me. Who does he think he is? Cue malicious compliance. I knew that the bug would not manifest itself immediately. There were certain conditions that had to be met for it to show itself in a production environment, and it didn't do anything wrong, it would just crash the system unexpectedly. I asked him one final time in the email thread whether he's sure he wants me to go ahead with the patch. He says yes. Alright, yay. Now we have a buggy code running on a production machine which moves $1 million every minute. Nothing happened for 3 months. Life was as usual. Then, last week, it finally happened. Our system crashed. Well, we have protection set up for such failures that roll back the binaries automatically. However, the crash still cost the company a few hours of downtime, which means potentially hundreds of thousands of dollars lost. The crash was traced back to the patch that Mr. Senior Developer had written. I had the email trail to absolve myself of fault. The resolution was quick, and needless to say, Mr. Senior Developer no longer works with us now. I'm not in middle school. I'm 23. This happened 2.5 years ago when I was 23. I was still in college and had a part-time job through my university as a tutor in a middle school. I worked with kids during the school day. It wasn't an after-school program, so there were always teachers and staff patrolling the hallways to check for hall passes. Most of them recognized me and realized I was a tutor, not a student, though many had asked to see my hall pass before this incident. To be fair, I'm 5 feet tall and I weigh around 95 pounds. Many, if not most, of the 7th and 8th graders were bigger than me, and I can see how I might blend in if you failed to notice my tattoos and face that screams exhausted, hungover college student. One particular day, I arrived between classes. There were specific paths they were supposed to take so that each hallway only had kids going in one direction to avoid traffic jams, as the hallway posters called it. In order to assert myself as the grown woman I was, I walked the wrong way. Otherwise, it would have taken me about 5 extra minutes to get to where I needed to be. I swiftly moved my way through the crowd, low-key intimidated by the hormonal, acne-ridden 6-foot middle schoolers towering above me, wishing I wasn't wearing leggings and a t-shirt like all of the other students. I was turning the corner and almost to the class when an elderly teacher grabbed me by the shoulders and physically turns my body around to walk the other way. I'll call her DET, Deteriorating Elderly Teacher.
What do you think you're doing? You need to follow the arrows. How confusing is it for you?
Me. Oh, sorry, ma'am. You don't understand. I
do not talk back to me. I don't want to hear it.
She turns my body the other way yet again.
Goodbye.
She was scary enough that I strongly considered walking the way she wanted me to go when I suddenly remembered I was 23 and couldn't get in trouble at a middle school. I turned back around. Me. I'm just trying to—
You have one last chance before I take you to the principal for this disrespect.
Me. I—
That's it.
She proceeds to grasp my arm with her frail elderly hands and lead me to the principal's office. At this point, students were taking notice, and for the first time in 10 years, I felt like an embarrassed 13-year-old. I saw one of my students, a 7th grader, laughing uncontrollably, and she said, "Don't worry, miss. I'll tell everyone you got taken to the principal." I thought Karen might have heard this, but she was very elderly, so she didn't. I shake her hand off my shoulder and turn to face her, trying to look as grown up as possible, even sliding my sleeve up so she can see my tattoos. Me. "Lady, with all due respect, I'm a tutor here. I'm not in middle school. I'm 23. Please, I'm going to be late for my work, and you're wasting both of our time by taking me to the principal." It finally sinks into her head that I am not, in fact, a student here. I see her eyes glancing down at my tattoo, then slowly rising back to my face.
"Oh my, why didn't you say something? I am so sorry. It's chaotic in here and you look very young. Please forgive me."
Me. "It's fine, but you didn't really give me a chance to speak up. I hope you give the kids a chance to speak up before grasping them and taking them to the office, you discreet old jerk."
I bet all the students despise you. Rightfully so.
Okay, fine. I didn't say that last part, but I deeply regret not doing so this day. After this occasion, I tried a little harder to look my age while tutoring, and my 7th grade students never let me or anyone else forget this happened.
You're on a roll, so don't stop now. Come watch this video next, and we'll see you when you get there. We'll give you a special shout out in our next video if you support our channel by joining as a member today. And hey, why not have us make a video reading your script for you? Just head over to our Fiverr, link pinned in the comments below.